Okay. So, very warm welcome to everybody who's here and who's back home streaming. My name is Pablo Llambias, and I'm a writer and I'm a teacher at the RMC Rhythmic Music Conservatory. And I'd like to present the series of which this is a part. And I'm reading aloud. This conversation today is part of a series of events organized by RMC Rhythmic Music Conservatory in collaboration with both present and former students, activists, and a string of NGOs. The event series is titled Spring Gatherings, and the overall aim is to address how categories of gender, ethnicity, and mental conditions affect our possibilities to make and work with music and art, and therefore also how it affects attending an art school. This conversation is the last of the four Spring Gatherings events, and from here on, the thoughts, topics, questions, and concerns raised during these conversations will be summed up and presented to the board as well as the Diversity Council at this educational institution. So far, so good. So, our focus today is mental conditions and how to apply for, how to be at, and how to leave an art school. And we are four, as we can see today. And actually, Jan Strikker from the school, he presented the series, and I thought that the collaboration with Birgit, in which I'm actually working on now, which is writing workshops and other workshops at the psychiatric institutions here in Copenhagen, was the starting point. And we presented the project here, and then we also invited to students and former students, Anna and Anna here today. And they are going to present themselves, and I hope they'll present themselves related to the topic that we are trying to talk about today. And maybe you, Anna, will begin.
Presenting myself?
Yes.
Relating to the topic?
Yes.
How much information is needed? I'm not sure about that.
Yeah. How much you want, actually.
Okay. I am currently a student at this school. On the bachelor, I study composition and songwriting. I work in like a field of performance art and sound art and pop music. I work with very like local sounds, like local to my body. And I also work, I'm also an activist, or whatever you can call it. I work with queer feminist topics. And I have been working with my position as a, I would call it a user of psychiatry. Yeah, for many years now. And I work with it both like in alliances, politically, in artistic ways, and also like with myself, therapeutic. Yeah, I'm currently also in using psychiatry.
Yes.
And other forms of therapy. Yeah, I think that's... Yeah.
That's for now. Thank you very much. Anna, would you like to continue?
Yes. My name is Anna as well, and I am a writer. I mainly write poems. I have published one book in December called Hinnebær, and it mainly takes place at a psychiatric hospital and many other places, I hope. But yes, then I'm also, what was it, on the web, on the Facebook, it said mental health consumer, I think. Mm. You said user of psychiatry. Yeah.
Okay.
I am that as well. And then I have been for 2 years now since I graduated from the creative writing school. I have been in Birgit's project, which is a a research project originally with workshops, writing workshops for psychiatric users. Yes, I've been in that project for 2 years now.
Right.
So that's me.
Thank you. And Birgit?
Yeah, my name is Birgit Bundesen. I'm a consultant psychiatrist at the Mental Health Care Center Amager. And before I studied medicine, I studied comparative literature and have been engaged with, I've been very interested in the connection between psychotic language production and modernistic poetry. And for me, psychiatry is a very privileged place to listen to stories. So my literary education, I think, has been a benefit for me in my clinical practice. We also know each other. I think we should say that because I've been the leading psychiatrist at the ward where you have been admitted, or where you are admitted when you are at hospital. Mm. So in that way, it's also been a relation that has been developed, because you also have a professional relationship, because you've been participating in the writing workshops and contributing, like Pablo also has, to us understanding what creative writing can do if you are in a state of mental crisis. Mm. Can it be used to master life? I think maybe you don't know it, but like our main hypothesis was to study the creative writers and see could we describe what you do in managing life with writing and teach it to someone else. Mm. You were a student at the Creative Writing Academy already when you started, so in that way you were already in a process where you used poetry to investigate life.
Survive. As well, yeah.
investigate your place in life, yeah. Somehow. Mm. And we also have been in a process where we have tried to use poetic language to find a way to describe what's going on in the States, for example, of psychosis. And how you can maybe find a creative language for something that is not verbalizable, something that doesn't have a language. So that was kind of my starting point.
Yes. Mm. And allow me to introduce myself in relation to the topic as well, because I have been an art school student as well, actually at two art schools, at the Classical Conservatory and also at the Royal Academy of Fine Arts. And both places, especially the Royal Academy of Fine Arts, I found a very hard place to be, actually. I have a story of anxiety and angst and the feeling of never being good enough for my whole life. But actually, it got worse when I got teacher. But when I became a teacher, feeling not really in having the right to be in the position where I were, and never. So I have also a story of attending a psychiatric session and being a user as well, and I have been writing about it extensively as well. But of course now I'm in a double position. I could speak as a position from a position of a student, but of course I'm also now speaking from a position as a teacher, but also partly as a position of being a part of this institution. And what the institution, I think, is trying to learn is to learn how better to make it possible for people with mental conditions and other conditions, to make it easier for people to be here and to apply for and to do the entrance exam and to be there and doing the exit as well. And I think that might be a starting point from how it is to apply for and go into the opening exam. But I hope for this afternoon we also try to deal with the fighting and the battle we're doing with ourselves in order to produce art. itself, that's also kind of a very lonely struggle where you meet your limits and you meet expectations and possible assessments out there all the time. So I hope we'll get around that too. But as you previously former student, active student, maybe I could give the word to you and try to describe what it's like to apply for and get into the school. What does it feel like? What are the issues around that? Maybe Anna.
So I had an experience when I got into. I applied several times in order to formally get in. But my experience was when I did get in and I was actually attending the school the first year. I had this experience that I actually needed to apply twice, and the first time was this like me being like passing as a healthy person who wanted to attend the school on the conditions that the school has structured. And then when I got in, I realized that I'm actually not able to be here with my whole self. And I realized that the school, of course, like all other places in society, is structured around in norms, which are structured around our understanding of an ideal person in a way. And of course, here, there's also some kind of understanding of an ideal musician. And that's certainly, I don't live up to those ideals on many levels. And I realized that the further away I am from the ideal, the less access I actually have to the resources that the school have. So I needed to talk with my school and like actually make an agreement on how I can be here on the conditions that the premises that I am able to work under, and that has been really difficult because there's no language about this. There's no recognition that that there are these like two ways into the school, and even though you are formally in here, you're not necessarily in here like with the access to that everyday classes. So it's for me it's been a lot of work to recognize the work that I'm doing and the way I am working as valid.
Can I ask a question?
Please.
Yeah.
It's just for me to understand coming from the outside. So this idea of the ideal musician, how do you see that? How do you feel that somehow a narrative about someone who's not just competent and healthy, but also elitist and able to produce and be a little above average human productive, humanly productive. So how does it show when you enter? And I'm asking because we have regularly at my ward, which is a ward for young people, people who come from these artistic institutions, and where it is like a very big pressure, this idea of an ideal that you should live up to, and how does it show?
Yeah, and that is tricky because nobody says this is the ideal, but you just see it in all the arrangements. So it becomes when I don't live up to the norms, then it becomes my job to point it out, and when I do, then I'm punished in another way. I don't know about the formal application.
No, it's not that it's written in the application. This is like
it doesn't
live up to.
No.
But when I listen to someone like Pablo, who's been attending artistic education his whole life, and he still has this feeling of not being able to fill up So where is this kind of idea? Is it something
I see it in the way the school is structured? I see it in the way, like, how often do we have lessons, and how many projects is expected of you? Like, how many projects are you expected to, like, juggle between? How productive in the like normalized way of thinking production are you expected to be? Like, what is there is like an understanding of what a song is, for example, what a finished art piece is. Like, if I just come with my thoughts, or like a weird written note, or a memo I have recorded,
So you have to have a product.
Yeah, and I have to also figure out what is the expectation of what a product is. Mm-hmm. What I experience is that this school, like many other, like all other institutions in our society, is very much organized around a market where art is where you see art as having value if it has a place in the market. And in that way, of course, it refers back to the person who makes this this art. Then, like, if I can make something that has value in a market, then I have value as well. And then I have, So I see that in the way, in these expectations also, like exams, how much, how long should your pieces be, and
I'm asking, so are there like formats where you have to like deliver a specific format? It has to be so and so long before it's finished. And
yes, and you have like to write this and this.
Criteria
exactly.
You have to write reports about. So it's not just the creative production; it's also that you have to deliver it.
Yeah, it's also
a product.
It's quite new at the Rhythmic Conservatory historically, seen that there are these very formal.
Yeah, but I don't think the way that the classes are structured, like there's this in music, this becomes like kind of music nerdy, but in music school you like traditionally have a main instrument that you play, and then you have this thought that you rehearse every day on this main instrument, and then you receive lectures, and like and that's a norm. That's a way of thinking. Okay, that's the musician. A musician sits every day with his instrument, and and I don't work that way. So
does it show in the way it's planned? It's just for understanding. So do you have to attend class every day?
Yeah.
So every day.
Every day.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's also part of an idea of someone who has to practice a lot and be present a lot and have to perform.
And be present in that way. Yeah, in that a way where you show up and you make
it's not
your
recognized
homework.
That contemplating can be a part of an artistic process, and that can be an incubation process.
Yeah, it's not recognized unless you can interpret it into like a report or a product.
They have to come a product out of
And someone else is approving, like, this is a product. But just me contemplating, or me like going around as it's not accepted. No, that is not accepted.
As a product. It has to be visible for someone else and presented in a formal way that others can kind of acknowledge.
Yeah.
Yes. Because I'm of course very interested, because we were out teaching at the Writers Academy when you were there also, and it's also about different kind of normal ideals for a musician than for us, the creative writers, for example, where maybe it's also a smaller institution, but maybe it's more accepted that you don't have teach classes every day, do you?
No, we had classes twice or three times a week, but it was still, I can recognize, it was still like 9 to 4, and it was always. I remember talking to some of my friends that I went to school with, because I have a hard time remembering that time, because I was very unwell when I went there. So what was I gonna say? I just lost my thought completely.
That the whole process where you got into the school.
No, not that.
That you tried to ask for leave.
Oh no, no, not maybe someone can talk. I'll return.
But because what I'm trying to ask for me to understand, because I'm not in an art school.
No.
And what I somehow see is that there's a difference.
You were asking what the expectations were.
But that there's also like a difference between the narrative of the elite musician and the narrative of the writer, where the writer is maybe more accepted, that the writer is someone who sits at home and contemplates a lot and walks around the streets.
Oh, and now I know what I wanted to say.
You don't have to perform in the same way.
I was just saying that we had we were taught 2 to 3 times a week from 9 to 4. And the first 3 hours is a reading where one student brings maybe 15 pages of text, and then you use 3 hours altogether reading this text. And the last 3 hours would always mainly be a writer who would come tell about his or her work, or some you came and taught us in inspiration and psychotic language. But the main thing was that we always had to sit down and concentrate and be a body in a room and pay attention. And I remember my friend Dennis, he told me that, who I went to school with, he said that Anna, every time we had, and that was not that often, but when we had like a meeting together, I would always say, can we do something practical? Can we go out in town and record some people doing some, can we write together? Can we do something where I can be activated, because I can't sit still. I remember just my whole time of being in the writing school, it's just a picture of me wandering out and in and out of that reading room, not being able to be in my body. I don't remember that well, but I remember anxiety. And
how did the institution kind of take care of that? Was it okay for you to walk in and out of the room?
Yeah, that was okay. And it must have been so annoying for the other students that I just kept on going in and out of that door. But we made some minor adjustments that should help me. I have a dog at home, and which makes me feel safe. And we had a dog basket at the school where she could lie. And I had a mattress in the corner so I could lie down if I felt I had to do that. And also the student secretary, she offered to bike to my house every morning, even though she didn't live nearby, and pick me up and take me to school, because I had a hard time getting out the door. And when I said that was too much, she arranged for a student to do that who lived on Amager like I do. But you asked me before, and the main thing I think that was problematic about my time at the writing school was that I was told this by a friend, because I couldn't remember it. I at some point asked to take a leave because I was so unwell, and it was not permitted. And I don't quite remember why I wasn't allowed. It was something structural that another student had taken a leave the year before, and then they wouldn't be able to admit as many the next year if I also had to be ill all of a sudden. And it was very upsetting.
So it was unflexible in that.
It was very unflexible. Yeah. And I do acknowledge that they did all those small adjustments to try and make me feel better there. But in the end, I can't help wonder if I had was been allowed to just use a year to maybe realize that I should take my medicine or whatever it should have taken for me to feel better, that maybe I would have gotten more out of my time. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But still, there's a difference between, and I think maybe it's because the creative writing school is a very small institution.
Yeah.
And this, I understand, is a very big institution. So it's more formalized here, because
and maybe also
and anyway, it's not allowed to bring your mattress and your dog to rehearsal. Or
I don't know. There are some things that are possible in some situations. Mm. I think the problem is like for me, when I have been not able, like this is not the first institution I'm attending. We are living in a society where we are institutionalized, so I have experienced not being able to or not wanting to sacrifice my health or my like well-being for being able to attending a school or like getting live up to some expectations in order to get resources, for example education. I have experienced that conflict, like as long as I remember. And the problem with then being in that role, where I then get a diagnosis so that the society can find somewhere to place me, is that I'm always living in a situation of dispensation. Like my rights to be in a classroom the way that my body can, like, or bring a dog or whatever. I always have to have that extra work with, like, applying, like, on other terms. And that becomes a reality where I actually have, like, several full-time jobs, being my own social worker, being my own therapist, like, or finding therapy, and then attending the whatever school or whatever I'm... So the institution puts the problem on the individual. Like, if you can figure a way to, like, become friends with the secretary or whatever, then that's good for you. But it's like, we don't recognize all that work. Pablo, you want to say something?
Yeah, what you said, Anna, reminds me of what they do in fundamental schools around learning styles.
In what schools?
In the folkeskolen. They have this idea of learning styles where, for example, people who can't sit still or don't want to sit still, they're able to move around, and there are also mattresses in the corner where they can. So because children are very different and they have different learning styles, so why? And they are big institutions. There are hundreds of students there. So even bigger institutions like this one could maybe learn a little bit from the smaller institution and from the folkeskolen as well. So that it's not only on dispensation that you can get these rights, but you can actually...
Yeah, because in reality it means that I have to... I have to say that I'm ill. I have to give up my authority and my reality in order to get access to the resources. And like if we... Like when I started at the university, it was before this reform, Fremdriftsreform. I can't translate that. And yeah, it was just after that, and that meant that a student a year before me could actually just not attend an exam without having to have a doctor's note or whatever, but I have to on these new conditions like announce myself as ill. I had to get a diagnosis, blah blah blah, blah, this whole system. So that's just a really clear image of that illness is not like something that comes from within me, or like it's not it doesn't, the illness that I, the diagnosis that I get, it doesn't necessarily mirror the pain that I feel or the pain that I need help with, and I don't necessarily see the same things as a problem as the society does or the institution does.
So you feel forced to kind of take on the diagnosis to get the rights to, to perform on the with the body and the nervous system that you have. So it's also talking into this whole discussion about neurodiversity, which is like also in America a big discussion at university, because the whole law and the rules at institutions are written for so-called normal nerve systems,
so and able-bodied,
able-bodies, and that the neurodiverse, which is like a growing population, they need to then apply to get special conditions, or and along with that act, you have to kind of take the identity on that you were somehow different, or that you need special care, and instead it should be written into the norms that, of course, this should be like...
Yeah, and not that some people are ill and some people are healthy. I think that's like a very poor dichotomy.
Dichotomy?
Like, yeah, dichotomy. But that we are all different. We all know that. We all experience, sometimes we meet the wall. Like if we have the flu, we can't go to work for a week. And then we experience that, like, okay... Now I can't live up to my, the productive value that I have in the capitalist society. But for some people, it's like a thing we experience all the time. And I think we need to stop talking about like people who are disabled and don't function, but look more at like what kind of conditions can we make where people can, like, where we can actually get these resources out in
For me, the paradox is, like, someone who's interested in consciousness and how consciousness work, and that the place where you have to place yourself when you are creative, there's a reason why people are not creative all the time, because it's also a very potentially anxiety provoking place where things are very open, where you are receptive to objects in the world, and you always see the not possible. Mm-hmm. So you have to open up for your sense of possibility in a way that can also be associated with anxiety. And so-called normal people educate themselves, or their nervous systems are synchronized in a way so they learn to structure their senses and their bodies in a way where they can create a sense of the world being solid. And that's why people cannot be creative all the time. If you have to place yourself in the creative modus, then you have to open up for all different kinds of possibility, also the very anxiety provoking. So the thing that when we talk about inspiration, that thing can be inspiring because they talk to you, they address you, can also be a negative thing because it can also have a demonic side where people can, the objects and different other people can feel threatening and things. So for me, like from a psychiatric point of view, I would say that the place where you place yourself as a creative person also is a place where you make yourself very vulnerable to a lot of possibilities. And for me, it just doesn't make sense that there isn't some kind of very natural consensus about that at the artistic institutions. Mm. That's something that you have to write into kind of the whole institution as a space where that can contain these kind of differences, yes. And also be able to handle the things that can come out with the so-called creative process. Eh?
Yes, because as I remember my time at the school, we didn't, it was not spoken of, this anxious place where you write from, everyone writes from or makes art from, I think. I know that my roommate is a student at the Creative Writing Academy now. The Creative Writing Academy now. And I know from him that after Ursula Anke Olsen became the principal, there's been done a lot of initiatives. For instance, when they begin the year and end the year, they have some educated therapists called study check. Yeah, and they facilitate like a conversation in the beginning of the year where the now second year students, they sit in front of the rest of the school and they talk about their or are questioned and talk about their challenges with being creative, with going to the school, with the reading room, and in the end you then talk to the next second year students about how they can help receive the new students well. And then also the teachers have meetings during the year with these therapists.
So they've tried to think some kind of process where you can kind of facilitate
speak of these things. Because when I went there, we were very alone with our processes and I think everyone felt very anxious about. And if you didn't, I already suffered from anxiety, but I think most people did afterwards because it was... also, I think you talked about the whole thing about accessing a room with a body and you have different access to different rooms. I also think that was one of the things that made the reading room situation, the 3 hours I described where you read one student's text, made that room so anxious, was the fact that... I don't know if you know, if you can... recognize this, but the idea of like the myth of art as being free, the myth of the free room, like that we are here on the same terms, and because that's not true. We are here on really different terms, and that was not spoken of. So, I mean, the fact that, because I also recall how I naturally even though I didn't want to weigh the teacher's words much higher than the other students when they talked about a text, or but it was always like, no, but we're on the same terms, we're sitting around a round table, but there are always power structures, and there were a lot of, but they were not talked about, and I think it's not a problem that someone takes the power in a room and says, I want to say this about a text, but you have to be open about it, I guess.
Yeah.
And that was, I think that was quite an reason, it made it like to an insecure room.
Of course, and also I definitely recognize that, and also that idea of art being free or like coming from a neutral place, and we all come from a neutral place of just listening, because now we're here. And then the double work that you are on with just like access in the room is not talked about, so it's just something that you have to deal with yourself.
Exactly.
And I think for me it's like if what I have learned also about my nervous system is that, first of all, I have a nervous system. I am a physical body. I am not a head with thoughts. And I cannot access a place of creativity if I don't feel safe. Like, safety for me is the key word to everything that has to do with curiosity and learning and being in contact, being in eye contact. So, and we all have different conditions for feeling safe in a room. Like, one thing I can, like a concrete thing is that when we apply, get into this school, like some people have a safe family, they have support from home, like parents who can give them a hug or make food for them, or they have been safe enough to get knowledge or contacts or whatever, and I have not been safe enough. I've been in a survival mode most of my life, and I don't have a family that is a safe place. So from that place where the world is difficult and you have to deal with death and illness and like dysfunctional, insecurities, and where you might, I have difficult, like, also because of my position, it's been difficult for me to get a home and to get a regular income. These basic things that makes everybody feel safe, and then there are some like individual things that makes me feel safe, for example, they have not been there in order for me to like just throw myself into the creative process, which is like a place where you have to have your curiosity, and you don't know what will happen. You don't have control, and you always have, and you also have to have access to your body, your senses. Like for me, art and music especially is about the senses, and if you have like a lot of traumatic experience, that makes it difficult to access your senses, because then also all these like its pain comes.
Other material.
Yeah. Then you don't have the same conditions. It's just like getting into the rehearsal room and pick up the guitar. And that I think really needs to be recognized.
Because that's also actually a big problem, I think, in the mental health care industry, that there's this very big work about equal treatment for everybody. And the argument I always get from other doctors is that, well, these writing groups, they're not for art groups are not for everybody. But no, they aren't.
No.
But medicine is not for everybody either. And there's no treatment that is, you know, for everybody. And everybody has a unique place where they stand. So if I have someone who's suffering from depression that I have to help, and they are homeless, and they're involved in gang kind of criminal activity, and they only have like conflicts all around, then it's a different situation for me to treat him if I have to kind of make him healthy, because I can do so and so much in the hospital space. But afterwards, I know that he will be more vulnerable to develop a new depression because I put him back in his natural environment. So this whole thing about, you know, that there has to be equal terms for everybody in the institution, which is kind of like, I think, an illusion. But I'm also very interested in what you say about the combination of safety and creativity. What we're very engaged with in the project is the combination of having a safe space, a containment space. And that's why there's always like a co-therapist, a mental health care worker in the workshop who is participating on equal terms. But if we have to kind of, you know, use like psychological language to describe it, and then there's this psychologist, Winnicott, who in the 70s kind of studied small children and their so-called normal development. And he kind of recognized that for a normal child to develop normally, it had to feel safe. It had to be able to play. And to be able to allow yourself to play, you have to have a good enough caretaker next door that make you feel safe to be able to play. And if the child would not be able to play, it could not develop a so-called normal or healthy mind. And I think it all still counts for adults that to be able to allow yourself to enter a playful modus where you investigate the world and yourself and your relation to the world and other objects and other people, you have to feel safe, because if you're anxious, then you cannot go into that modus, because then it's all stuck here. And I think it's just a very important relation that you have to acknowledge it to be able to go into creative modus and the playfulness.
Yeah,
that is a very important motor in it.
Yeah,
then you have to be able to create a safe space.
Yeah.
Or a containment space where you can actually unfold these things, or else your whole nervous system is programmed to defend yourself.
Yeah.
And if you're in a
defense, it's in a survival mode. And when you're in a survival mode, everything is about surviving, not thriving, not.
No.
So it's actually a very good thing that the body does. If it experiences something threatening, then it goes
it
into
tries
the
to survive.
It tries to survive.
You attack, you freeze, or you try to play dead. That's what animals do
But there's also another
state. Your body.
I've seen students both at the Art Academy and at the Writers Academy who's taking works of art in the room that they feel safe, that they won't be attacked in the room.
Bringing work that is safe
or accepted in the room and not taking the experiments and what they're not sure about into the room because they're afraid of the assessment.
That's a
very bad thing when the room doesn't support experiments and drafts and investigation of new field and people are taking safe
that the process
projects
is not written,
into
that
the room.
That's bring
a very
something
bad
that
sign.
Is maybe a work that you engage with, memos you have or ideas that you have, that you cannot bring that into the process as something that is not finished yet, but that you want to investigate. That would also be like
it would
very
be very nice if I don't they probably talk about it at the school now, but it would have been nice to maybe like in the beginning of the school to, I know they do that, they have that on the schedule now, but have a class where you talk about, this is a room of playfulness, you have to you can experiment if you feel like it. And just for me it would have been, because I was in a place where I could not distinguish myself from others, other objects, other people, my own text, myself, what was, who was I, what was this, everything just was a big chaos for me. So when I was, when I had critique on my texts, I became very unhappy, because I was always told that my work was too feminine, it was too saturated, I was not allowed to talk about God. I was not told that I was not allowed. But people would like smash the table with their fists and be like, "Oh, I don't want to hear any more about God." And I became very upset, because it was my way writing. The reason I write is because that's my way of arranging the world. It's a way of understanding the world and understanding myself in relation to the world. It's a way of just making sense of it all, because everything is very chaotic sometimes, most of the times. But anyway, so when they criticized me, I needed some help from someone, I think, to tell me, hey, they're not criticizing you. It's not because they don't understand your view of the world. Someone who could, I learned that after I stopped in the school, that I was not my writing, and because how should I know, you know?
Yeah.
But you remember when you started in a writing group, you came with this whole background from the creative writing school, and it was difficult for you to just allow yourself to just play there.
Yeah.
And do something that you would not do otherwise because you had a style and you know...
The rules and the ideas. And
but also, I think it's important that to also say this about safety, that safety is not like something you can just find within yourself if you...
No.
I'm not saying that anybody said that, but I think that's an illusion sometimes that like, but then go and feel safe or like go to a therapist and like just try to drag it out of yourself. Mm. Safety is something that appears, like this feeling of safety is... It's a part of our nervous system, which is not the survival modes that you just mentioned, but it's another part that is the social engagement part of the nervous system. And that is the part we access when we feel safe enough, when there are not triggers, or like sufficiently less triggers, or and sufficiently like, you can say like safety cues.
But they are actually two different sets of nerves. It's the sympathicus and the parasympathicus.
Yeah,
so they
two
can't
branches
be activated at the same time.
No. So when you are in that, and I think the important thing is that you have to have these safety cues. It's not something you have to invent in your head. You have to like, have a space that is safe. And one thing that is a trigger for me is when my work is being judged from like some norms which are not clearly outspoken, like these when things are being taken for granted, that can be like a huge trigger. Then it's I think then sometimes this like anger or whatever, like this unwillingness to be in the room, that the body doesn't want to be in the room, it's actually because like something is being unclear, it's like it's not safe enough, it's not visible, like these norms that we are organizing around, and that kind of makes these other voices go underground, and then it becomes anxiety instead of voicing that anger and being like, hey, it's not okay to say that. It's basically not a good critique to say I don't want to hear about God. I mean,
I was very upset about the comment about that I always got about, because I write a lot about like butterflies and feminine objects, you know. Mm-hmm. Inventory.
I know.
I was very upset about that.
But like, I'm sorry for like bringing in this whole psychological language. Other thing that Winnicott coined was the idea about the transitional phenomena or the transitional object, that for the child is the first possession that you need to use to detach yourself from the mother or to walk into the world as a safe space.
Mm-hmm.
So for the child, it is typically a thumb, a soother, a teddy bear, or nursery rhymes it could also be. So having this objectified part of yourself that you can move out into the world with, that could maybe be a text or a creative project that you can kind of use to structure a space where you could use it to feel safe about the world, but where something of your inner life can somehow be objectified in a way that you can actually investigate it and share it with others. And to do that, you need a safe environment somehow. And the question is, how do you kind of, as an institution, kind of provide the frames where these questions can be asked? So, of course, you can't just say to people, feel safe, but you can, alone by addressing the question, see if you can kind of meet people in a way where you can produce the frames where you can feel safe enough to engage in the playfulness.
Yeah, I also think, for me it's important to start having these talks, and also a thing that's really important to me, or how should I say this, an experience I have had is that that it's really difficult to be listened to when I'm angry, or if I have a critique of the norms, and especially being a woman, I have experienced in like so many places that that has actually been a cause to sometimes sickening me, like, or saying like, okay, we can't have pathologize so my experience has been that I have in many situations had to have a strategy where I have to choose either to be ill and in need of help, and then give up my authority, like just get the help, whatever it is, even though it's not good. Or if I voice my anger and or my resources, just like I actually need, I know what I need, I just can't get it myself, I need your help. Then I don't get the resources, then I don't get the help, because it like it has to be either or. And what I think would be really great help would if we could make space to be both and, and start to listen to the critiques, and not just trying to silence the critiques by saying okay so you are ill, so we make like a specific like path for you in this institution, but actually listen to it as resources that we can use to organize in a different way. Because I actually think that there are a lot of people speaking up, we just don't listen to it. Yeah.
But as far as I understand, then this arrangement is kind of like initiative from the institution to kind of start facilitating this kind of conversations, because that's why I said yes to attend, because I thought it was a very nice process. So maybe it just starts like this, with having formats where you can actually talk about it. I would be very curious about hearing you, Pablo, about having also been in a writing, the creative writing institution and the conservatory here, like the idea of the ideal artist. Do you think it's different when you perform like for the musician than for the writer? And how has it been for you historically, this culture of when you were a student, was it okay to voice your anger or being criticized?
First, I would like to address the ideal of we are all equal. That's a very dangerous ideal, and I see its roots in the 70s, because in the 70s the authoritarian manly system was attacked, and that was good actually, but it left an open space for where everybody could grab the power in the, but still being in the ideal of we are all equal, and thereby there was raised some kind of a meritocracy. As a, you are as good as your work are. The work, the good work, and the norms of the actual norms give you the power in the room. So the teachers in the art schools, they are meritocrats, they are the best artists. And I also saw that there was the power system in the art school classes, and also in the writer school was based on who was the best artist, so who was accepted. And I saw these cliches building and power structures among the students, and also in alliances with some of the teachers. And it was not spoken of, these hierarchies and these power structures. And it was ironic, we are in the late 90s in the Art Academy, where gender studies came. Judith Butler was a guest. And we have post-colonial studies as well. So we had all the instruments for power and analysis of power structures, but the class was kind of innocent in that sense. But of course it was not. And then I remember at the fellow school, and there came an American teacher, and he asked the students some of the questions that you asked the students. Well, why do we produce art, he asked. How do you like being here? All of these questions, and people got embarrassed, both students and because it was too vulnerable. We don't talk about that. So the embarrassment in the room was also a part of the tradition. We don't talk about what we feel at the art school. And of course, that made the system continue, that we don't talk about it. So we have had the media to talk about it for 40 years now, but we had not used it until now. So these old structures, we really, it's been hard to eliminate and get rid of.
But does it go further back to kind of like a romanticist ideal about the artist being some kind of, you know, receiving some kind of divine power, where you would kind of be a little overhuman, and that does it still live? Because what I hear you all say is that nobody talks about it, but everybody knows it. Everybody knows that there's some kind of ideal I have to live up to. It's not written in the laws.
I don't think everybody knows it or are conscious of it. I think that
you only
the people
feel it
who
when you flip out of it.
Yeah, when you meet the wall.
Yeah.
Then like.
So if you're in it, then you.
Then you're just floating.
You're floating. Yeah.
Like it's because what we don't recognize that we all need help. We are all dependent on each other. This idea of an independent. Like neoliberal,
yeah.
That is an illusion. Like, but as a society, we have just chosen to help the people who are like closest to the ideal. So that's why we have stairs. Like that is a help, for example. But it of course only helps people who have legs. So, yeah, in that kind of way, we can. The person who is closest to the ideal doesn't really feel the help that they get, because we have normalized it and we say that we in some ways we actually say that person is more worth.
So one helpful thing could be to just acknowledge that there are hierarchies.
Yeah.
Instead of pretending there's.
And that everybody gets help.
Absolutely. Yes.
But that we just like we choose as a society to help somebody more than we choose to help
because
others.
Because like I'm just asking the stupid questions because I come from outside.
Yeah,
so if you are someone who is capable of living up to the ideals at the institution, then you also lift it up a little bit about this narrative of the capable artist as someone who's supernaturally inclined. That it's also an identity that is very attractive to call upon yourself.
Yeah, definitely. You get all the resources.
Because like, you are the elitist.
Yeah, and you just have free access. And yeah, and you don't have to talk about like, what did I get for breakfast or not get for breakfast, or do I have an eating disorder? And how does that affect my work life and the things that I'm producing, the music that I make? You don't have to talk about it because it's just accepted that as a norm, as like that's the right. So I think it's important to start look at the music we listen to, for example. Like it has been produced by certain bodies, and like if I see like I was just one day looking at a Radiohead live session recording, and I just started thinking like. Who made breakfast for these guys? Who built the guitar? Who made sure their clothes was like clean or kind of clean? Who gave them a hug when they cried? Who is taking care of their kids? Like all these things that we don't see that is actually a part of the music because of course we hear the sound of bodies that has been living these lives. Like the aesthetic is formed by the ways the lives are lived, and of course that brings forth these voices that are, idealized, and then all these other voices are not heard, except from like, then the wife I suppose can make a special kind of breakfast that shapes this body, you know. So it always. Yeah, I don't know if you know,
yeah, so
understand what I mean.
It's a balance between not pathologizing neurodiversity, but also not normalizing, because it's something we've been talking about, that it's also difficult when people try to say, well, I know how it is to have an off day, and you feel that it's not what's happening to you, that normalizing some of the difficulties that you have is also kind of a problem, eh?
To me, it is. It is a problem, yes, because I do not feel acknowledged in my struggle. Then I have an example is now it's about psychiatry, not about art schools. But I was just in the hospital last month in your ward, And I came out crying, and there were some nurse students who were sitting in the couches, and then they told me, I went to them, that all the regular staff were in a meeting, so I couldn't come to any of them. And then I went to one of them, those nurse students, and cried to them, and they said, oh, well, we also sometimes feel ups and downs, and life goes, you know, mm-hmm. I experience pain as well. And that was just so, it was, I became even, then I heard from another patient that you shouldn't talk to those people, so I stopped. But
I think it's very important to address,
yes,
the differences, that we're mm-hmm. not equal. So I cannot allow myself to say, like, we're all equal here. Like, if we're in the writing group together, then I'm there in a different way than you. That you are mm-hmm. there, and to pretend that we are there on the same term, I think it's an insult. Mm-hmm. So not acknowledging that there's a power difference, and when I say something, it has a different resonance in the room than if mm-hmm. you say something. Mm-hmm. And of course, these hierarchies are there, and alone, we cannot make them go away. These structural positions that we are put into places with, that we take with us into social situations, but mm-hmm. at least acknowledging them mm-hmm. is kind of, I think, is respectful,
yeah.
because I actually get paid to sit there, mm-hmm. and it's different for you.
Yeah, you who go are there home for afterwards.
And I go home afterwards. Yeah. So, so this thing about addressing the differences and not and also acknowledging that there are. That we cannot look into other people, because sometimes patients say to me, you don't know what it's like to be me, and that's right, mm-hmm. I don't, but you don't know what it's like to be me either, because we cannot look into other people, mm-hmm. but we can acknowledge that there's difference between you and me, mm-hmm. and alone that is, I think, is a place where we can start a conversation.
Because and start to listen to, like, yeah. the experience that each person has, instead of looking in a book over, mm-hmm. like, mm-hmm. What are the standards of explaining, like, and also explaining, instead of explaining a lot of symptoms, then actually start to listen to what are these bodies experiencing, because
that's actually why
I think sorry. It's different levels. Mm. Like, there's me, there's like my role in an institution I have, like, I'm part of, and the help I get there or the help I don't get, the resources I have access to there, and then there's me on a personal level, and the pain that I have, that I have to struggle with, or like finding room for. Mm. And that's not necessarily the same. What I'm trying to say is that even though I say on a, even though I don't want to say on like a personal level that I'm ill, that doesn't mean that I don't have pain, that I'm suffering. I just don't, it's just not necessary for me to call it an illness in order to get the help. It's on a like, a societal level that mm-hmm. I need to call it an illness in order to get the help that I need.
Yeah.
And that's the problem.
Mm. Yes.
No, yeah. I always just wanted to say quickly that it just makes me think of, I brought these today because I made them with another writer called Cecil Weldon. And our project was to make pamphlets for the doctors in psychiatry, because when you're a patient in psychiatry, you always get all these pamphlets, and that's like power tool to, I don't know, mm. but
go
we wanted
walk,
to
listen to music, blah, blah, blah.
It was just you know, yeah, like taking owning your own vulnerability and making it a weapon that you can use, and using their power discourses opposite, not against them but to them, talking to them. So we made three, I forgot one of them, but one of them is like good advice for the doctor. Mm. And we also made one, what you said before about, we wrote, because I also am very disturbed by the, when I hear clinical terms for my illness, like if the just the word psychosis, I don't like those words. So we wrote poems where we invent our own descriptions and words from what happens inside of us instead of looking in a book. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just wanted to mention
beautiful.
That.
Yeah.
Right. So, time is running.
Uh-oh.
It's 8 minutes past 5.
What is time?
Den er 8 minutter over 5. So I would like maybe to invite resources in the room and also on the streaming if somebody has questions or comments or stories, to invite them to share them with us. Could start with the room. Please feel free.
You're not in the camera.
No, you're very lucky.
Do you have any reactions? It would be nice.
Elsa, no, we have some questions from streaming here, and Jan is.
I would like to say something.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm.
Could
you introduce us? What's your name?
My name is Helle. I actually work here at RMC. I'm a study coordinator and also a student counselor. And I think it's a very interesting topic. I have been a user of not psychiatry, but psychologists, and have had mental crisis over my life. So I fully acknowledge this. I wasn't sure if I was going to speak or not, because I'm actually very aware of the power structure. Because here we have Anna, she's, I see her in my office, I see her at school, and I'm here talking as an employee. And I think it's very important that we talk about these issues.
Why do you think that?
But because I think it creates a lot of conflict and a lot of not well-being, if so to speak, because I think what we're doing here is actually we are talking about this from down up, and what the real problem is that we are all operating in a system which goes from up and down, which means, and I'm not trying to justify decisions or anything, all I'm saying is that perhaps it's not unwillingness, but perhaps it's tied hands, because we are in a system. We are all being forced to operate according to all these norms that the whole system is putting on top of us. So the reason, the thing here is, how do we actually, in a fruitful collaboration, change this? How do we find ways in this with the given conditions we have? Hmm. Because someone once said to me, if there's something you don't understand in the world, why are things as they are? There is one answer: money. And money is the answer, because why are rules as they are? That's because we get money from the state, and if we don't produce, then we don't get the money, then we can't do school, and then everybody in different ways, because we are all different individuals. We all try to cope, to operate, to maneuver through all the systems. So that's why I thought it was really important to take part in this, and I could just leave it there and not sort of speak from the other side. And I don't really want to be from the other side, because basically we are on the same side. And I think at the end of the day, we all want to achieve the best, and we all want to do the best, and perhaps, and we are operating from the abilities we may have from wherever we come. I think it's very interesting. You know, I'm sort of thinking, I would really like to talk to you, because I have students turning up in my office who are your clients. Mm. And I sometimes think, I'm not sure they really know what's going on here. Mm. Or could we make it better if we actually collaborated?
Mm. But it's a very interesting question, and I think I can kind of aloud these conversations that we had beforehand, before this talk, because some of us feel uncomfortable about being representations for big institutions. And the question is, how free are you to speak? And eventually also the question of Jakob Jakobsen, who's not here today, but who we have a very tight collaboration with, the idea about the discussion about how do you start change? How do you start a revolution? So if like we burn down all the power structures, like if you do in the French, like in the French Revolution, we cut off the heads of all the ones in power, all the ones with money. So what happens? Good question, eh? and but can you start revolutions in different ways? By so maybe the idea could be that maybe just bigger and more powerful institutions grow up because we haven't changed the structures between people that decide how power should be. So being placed in an institution that, of course, I have to be loyal to the Region Hovedstadspsykiatri, who pays my salary. But I think I still have the right to speak as a person, and that I can say that it's an institution that does a lot of good things, but it can become better. And if we don't start somewhere where we are, then we have to just give up, or have to just find another job. So how do we, I think that's a good question. How do we from within the institution kind of acknowledge that there is this differences, that there are power structures, and how do we facilitate or open up for dialogues like these without having to feel that we are not loyal to the institution, but we kind of facilitate dialogues and also contain all the critical voices, that they're also part of this, and that's the only way that we can become better at doing the service that we are employed to do. Services. I see myself as a service person, that I'm delivering a service, and if it's not good enough, then I have to kind of ask myself, what can we do better? Because the person I'm giving it doesn't benefit that person. So how do we as representation for institutions kind of facilitate these difficult talks in a way that we can become better?
Yeah, I think that also we have to be open to the idea that that this system might not be able to go on. I don't work at this school. I don't work in psychiatry, but I am inside it, and I'm in this school, and it's been a lot of work to get in here, and it's a huge privilege, and it's also a huge privilege to live in a welfare system. I also, like, with all the sacrifices I have made, I'm also actually able to attend a school here, which I'm not sure I would under different circumstances. However, I really feel a responsibility when I'm inside this institution to look at who are being pushed out of this institution. Like, and that's both, people who are non-white, people who are non-males, people who are able-bodied, and non-heterosexual. That's like, I feel a responsibility to look at how the structures push these people out and silence these other voices. And I am also actually willing to ask the questions, like, should a school like this exist if it excludes so many people, or if it only serves a very small, like ideal kind of human? I actually don't think so. I don't think it should be here at any price. So I'm also willing to, like, I can't, like, be here and not work with the structure and criticize it at the same time. I don't think it's an either or, then I can just leave and stand outside and criticize. I think it's possible, like.
So if you take the next step, so how do we then change this idea about a specific heterosexual, capable, with a normal nervous system person who is like the main student here?
You start to listen.
How do you start?
Not just listen, like, here, like, I hear you, but actually listen in a way where we take the consequences of what we hear. Like, when we start to hear voices saying, like, this is not working, I can't thrive, I can't live, like, this is too horrible, I can't even access this room. There are also consequences with having that knowledge, and I think that's why we don't want the knowledge, because then we have to deal with it in some way. We can't just ignore it. So of course, first start to listen to the voices, also the things that are really uncomfortable, and where I, like, for as a white person, I feel like hvad hedder det, truffet. hvad hedder det?
Involved or?
I feel my whiteness. I feel my whiteness. yeah, not guilty, but I think it's also important to take the consequences of, like, and trying to change things, not only just talk.
We have a few minutes left, and I know we have some questions from the streaming out. So is that okay? We take
them
now.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, and presented by Jan.
Yeah. So I'm Jan. I'm sitting behind the computer operating the live stream, and I have a question that addresses some issues that Anna Wærum raised early on in the conversation. First, there's a comment, and then there's a question in the end. Mm-hmm. Thanks for bringing up the discussion. There are definitely normative notions of what it means to be a musician or artist in the field of music going on at RMC, which is reflected in many areas, from teaching to production rehearsals and more. My question is about facilities. Which facilities, physical and non-physical, are needed to challenge these normative ideas?
Yeah. That's a huge question. It's like, let's have a new talk. There are, like, the list is endless. I don't know where to start. I think I have experienced in the class I am in now that there is a very, like, a space for example, bringing the work you have, acknowledging a student in my class is a place where that person needs to play a lot of PlayStation in order to survive right now, and we have brought that in as work and like recognized that as a way of working with sound and like being in the world, things like that. Okay, it's too big a question. It's too big a responsibility. But I think it's
I think we have in the exam form and in the music that you're giving in.
Yeah, yeah.
I think there should be more room for experiments and definitely more room for process oriented theses and not product oriented theses. That's
but also think like
suggestion.
we have to hand in some music that is like a certain amount of minutes. It's like we are being given a black box and we can just do whatever we want with that black box, but it's like really hard work to try to make art out of that instead of being given a safe space where we can be curious.
Yes. So that was one question, very shortly answered indeed.
Yeah. Very so important, big.
I know we
good
have
question.
At least one more question from out there.
Yeah, there is one more question. It's actually aimed at you, Pablo, but maybe it goes to both you and Birgit as authority persons. It says, can you tell a little bit more about your angst or anxiety as a teacher? Why do you think you experience this?
Oh wow, is that a teacher asking?
We don't know.
We don't know. No. Well, it's rooted in the same way that my artwork should be good or relevant, and so what I produced as a teacher should be relevant and well founded in some ways and able to discuss itself, see its own angles, and I think it's a lifelong development. You never really learn it, and I also see anxiety as a good thing you can carry into the room just to be sure that because it's almost always somebody that's everybody's share, and it's a base, it's a foundation for producing art at all. But of course, it's not so funny. It's not funny, at least, if you are in a room that's very condemning. When you enter a room that could condemn you, you're really pissed. You're really fucked when you enter that room. But it happens a lot of times. When you're in a panel, for example, where it's like a, a race to say the best things and the clever things and stuff like that. It's not really nice to be there.
Can I comment?
So that's a room that I don't like to be in as a teacher, where it's a race. So that feels very uncomfortable for me as well. And I'm supposed to be somehow composed in the room, but I prefer to be not that composed, and I prefer if it's all right to be not that composed. But when I'm in a room where I sense it's not okay not to be composed, I don't feel like being there.
So if I can supplement, like I think for me it's very much about suddenly being expected to be the expert. It's a special kind of anxiety, because the longer that you are, at least the longer that I'm in psychiatry, the less the more humility I feel about saying anything very authoritative about anything, because it becomes more and more complex. So when people, and which comes with the doctor position, that people expect you to be expert in like anything, like in everything. So being put in that position is potentially very anxiety provoking, and you cannot allow to be the student. So sometimes you think there must be some grown-up person in the room that can answer this, because I cannot take on this responsibility. So I think it's very much about, it's a different kind of anxiety that you can experience as being seen as the authority, the teacher, the leader of the school. So you must have the answer to everything, and it's expected for someone who is below you or someone else in the hierarchy that you would have the answer as the expert. And I think the development in becoming an expert is very much about maybe acknowledging that you will never really become an expert, and maybe being more comfortable with that. So I think it's this discrepancy about being expected to be expert on very complex matters, that you feel that you're not allowed to be doubtful, because you're expected to bring an easy solution and fix things.
Any comments?
Can I ask how many people are out there?
34.
Woo.
Okay. Are there any more questions from out there? No. Well, we are closing in. We have 4 minutes left. Is anyone in here wanting to say something?
Should we hear?
We should hear
some good advices for the doctors.
Good advice for the doctors.
Yes, it's in Danish. I don't know if that's
in Danish. Well,
I think it's okay. We can allow that.
The school says okay.
Do you want? Okay, so you want to hear the good advice for the doctor?
I would like to hear the other one.
Yeah, I think that one's funnier too. So this is. I can translate what it says on the front page to English, but it will be in Danish, the rest of it. It's called symptom translation. It can be alienating to having to relate to medical terms for your symptoms. It can seem impossible to express our symptoms with our everyday language. Here are some descriptions we use when we talk about illness. Jeg var en kugle af hud og knogler. Alt det blå under og over mig havde intet med mig at gøre. Jeg kan kun tale om mig selv som noget, der er gennemsigtigt. Du må forstå, jeg er et slags bløddyr. Mine organer er ikke altid private, og det gør mig bange. Gør det umuligt nogle gange at gå på gaden. Forstå, jeg er fælles med de andre derude. Giv mig et klæde. Ofte svært at få vejret, ofte mølle i kroppen. Indeni skriver jeg ordet smertekugle, findes den, og jeg kan sætte mig og græde. Skriver jeg ordet skadesfjer, findes den og den, og another day, another chase. Det handler helt konkret om en hund, der løber væk. Det handler helt konkret om alle de store kattedyr, der jagter mig. Det handler om Alice, hvordan halsen pludselig kan strække sig helt. Eller forsvinde, hovedet bliver en ballon, der er lige ved at springes, men i stedet punkterer. Det handler om at pege på tingene og kalde dem med deres navn. Et ønske kl. 11 om
at hinden skal brydes, kuglen skal briste, og så se, hvad der vælter ud. Så se det i øjnene og ikke blive bange med en fugl, Phoenix. Og jeg er helt overbevist om den dag, det sker, der dør jeg og opstår på ny. Mit jeg er en spiral af skaller. Mine øjne er lameller. Alt ligger sig i mig, kan ikke sortere noget fra. Min mor sætter nåle i mine ører, stoler på mig, når jeg siger, at det flyder derinde under den tynde hud, 20 stik, lindring. Hun er ikke bange, når blodet render fra mine ører, tør det bort med en vaskeklud, siger så. Og skyernes lyserøde blodige plamager, de driver afsted. Vindmøllernes vinger roterer, rovfuglene, lys, lys, rød. Det bevæger sig i cirkler, rovfuglene, vindmøllerne, den riflede vandoverflade. Solen og månen, den tilbagevendende vinter, lyserødt lys. Farverne ligger i tynde lag over landet. Der er en hinde omkring alting. Der findes brudflader, berøringspunkter. Vi må ikke knække. Og himlen bløder mildt. Rosa, rosa gråd. Det handler om at holde sammen på det hele. Ikke lade for meget strøm ind eller ud. Så man må holde sig indendørs nogle dage. Bare ligge og ro på ægget. Og vandet bliver så dunkelt i lyset. En alges halefjer, dybblå og de hvide krusninger, blonde kanten. Jeg har en fjord på mit ærme. Det strømmer igennem mig. Vandet får sig for humledende, imens jeg langsomt tømmes. Min krop er tomme skaller og jeg. Jeg går på de tomme skaller og pillepakninger. Nej, blommuslinger og fuck. Himlen brænder. Det knitrer ildebrand. Jeg går under røgsøjlerne ved vandet. Det regner, tunge flager aske. Banker, bunker af tang. Det brænder, det brænder. Et flammehav, og kroppen bliver så tung og tom, så let den svæver. Det indvendige er et plastisk formløst noget. En fast transparent materie, der flyder rundt i luften. Der eksisterer konstante bevægelser i mig, fire begge, der løber parallelt i mit hoved, beholder for sproget. Jeg føler mig underligt i live ved tanken om dem, at de netop nu løber og render.
Thank you very much, Anna.
You're welcome.
And thank you, Anna.
Thank you.
Thank you, Birgit. And thank you, you, attending here. And thank you, all of you, streaming. So, thank you for today. Bye, everybody.
Tak. Mm.